Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for each person that's listening now. We pray, Lord, that you would be like the potter, Lord, and we would be like the clay. Lord, help us to be molded into more like you. Lord, help encourage us. Lord, help draw us ever closer to you, better understand who you are and how much you love us. And Lord, we just ask you now, use Pastor Izzy to reach each one of us. Lord, we ask that now in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone that says, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn in your Bibles to the book of Romans, chapter 1, as we're going to continue our in-depth study through the book of Romans. And this is the book that we began the church with on Sunday morning 24 years ago. It's really interesting to me to come full circle. And I've had the privilege, like I've shared before, to teach the entire Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, to this fellowship. And the first time took 15 years, and I don't think I'll ever make it again at my speed now. But you guys are going to get mad at me today. Listen, last week I covered all of the first, I would say the first verse, but it was really the first line of the first verse, because we spent an in-depth study learning about what does it mean to be a bond slave, a bond servant of Christ. That's how Paul introduced himself to the church at Rome. He's writing them a letter. Paul, if you're not aware of this, he was in Corinth, and we read about this in chapter 15 of the book of Romans. He had just taken up a collection for the poor saints that were in Jerusalem. Now, if you don't know the history at this time, you know, this is around 58 AD, and the church is being persecuted. And they're being driven out of Jerusalem and Judea, the Jewish areas. They're having to flee for their lives. And so as the church gets persecuted, what happens to the gospel? Does the gospel just fold up and quit? No, it spreads. You know, some people don't like that this is the result of persecution, but the persecution of the church has actually spread the gospel much more than if the church was left alone and comfortable. Because if we were left alone and comfortable, what would we do? Nothing, right? We just sit there and go, this is great, man. We're comfortable. I don't need to do nothing. I'll just stick around. But you know, I've noticed that the Lord has this way of taking us out of our comfort zone. Can anyone give an amen to that? Amen? And he has this way of putting us into positions and pushing us out of the nest, so to speak, so that we learn to fly like a baby bird getting its first flight lesson. It's not so pretty sometimes. You know, we crash, we burn, we go down. But the Lord doesn't care, because he looks at the bigger picture. Down the road, we're going to get our wings under us. We're going to get to learn to do it right. And so the Lord is, you know, Paul is in Corinth, and he's been being used of the Lord. You can read about this in the book of Acts, around chapters 18, 19, 20, how the Lord was using him in a mighty way. In fact, we just studied this with the kids on the youth group this week, about how the Lord, even handkerchiefs, Paul's sweat rags are called, as he was making tents there along the Mediterranean Sea. It's hot work, sewing by hand the tents. And he made tents so he could preach the gospel without charge to anyone. Do you guys know that Paul never took up a collection for himself? There's not one time we have a record of the Apostle Paul saying, could you guys raise some money for me? He didn't. The only collection we know of is the one he arranged for the churches to take up a collection for the poor that were in Jerusalem. And he said, by the way, could you do it before I even get there? Because I don't want to get there and have people think I'm just there for their money. Just have everybody that has a willing heart to give, let them give so that it doesn't stumble anyone. And when I get there, I'm going to stick to the main message, which is what? Tithing? No. The main message is the grace of God, preaching the gospel of Christ crucified for our sins. He said, I determined to do nothing else but to declare that Christ has died for our sins. So Paul, his heart was, he was actually in, when we get all the way to Romans 15, we'll see, he was out gathering up the collections for the poor as he's on his missionary journey, and he's going to bring it back to the suffering saints that stayed in Jerusalem. Now, this is home base for him. I mean, he was raised in Israel. He is a Pharisee of Pharisees. Yet we're going to see in this letter that his calling, although he was Jewish to the bone, I mean, to the core, this guy is going to be called an apostle, not to the Jews, but to the who? To the Gentiles. And this is what we're going to study today. Last week we saw he said, I am a bond slave of Jesus. In other words, I found the greatest master, and I willingly have volunteered to be in his service. I say, Lord, take me, I'm yours. And back then they put that gold hoop in the ear, and you wore it as a mark of respect to your master, saying, I am a slave here, but not because I'm indebted, but because I found out who the good master is. Now we come to the second line in his introduction. Now the reason I'm doing such an in-depth introduction to this book is because you will get so much more out of this book if you understand the depth of the young generation. They look at me like, you're a crazy man. Because they didn't have, in literary class, they didn't have a teacher like I did that broke it down. Taught me, when you go to read a piece of literature, you find out who wrote the thing. Who were they writing to? What was the circumstances? You know, what was going on at that time? And all of this just so that when you read the letter, you find out, well, you see more. You know, I shared this last week, but this is like a lost story. This generation growing up, they go, well, I remember my teacher saying who wrote it. Sometimes they said who they were writing to. I don't even remember that. And I said, that's a shame, because if you know some of these details, when you read the letter, all of a sudden the whole thing comes to life. And you see such beautiful things. And this is one of the things you need to learn. Paul the Apostle is now going to say he's not just a bond slave. And I reserve the right to come back to the next thing he calls himself. Or actually, he didn't call himself this. Listen to what he says. He says, I'm a bondslave of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. He said, I was called as an apostle. An apostle, the word comes from the Greek. It means a sent one. Sent, not a cent like a penny cent, C-E-N-T. S-E-N-T. Sent one. Someone who was sent. Who sent Paul to preach the gospel? Did he have a group, a church board, missions board that sent him out? Did Paul have any of these? I did this last week, but just for a refresher, turn to Galatians chapter 1, and let's see who he says was the one calling the shots on him being sent out. When he writes to the church of Galatia, he says, Paul, an apostle, not sent from men, nor through the agency of man, but through who? Jesus. Through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. You want to know who sent me, he says? Jesus and his Father, who raised him. Here he is, always proclaiming the resurrection of the Lord. He said, I'm not going to preach anything except Christ crucified and him resurrected. That's what the power of the gospel is. He says, even from his calling, he says, I was called, but I wasn't called from men. Now, why does Paul, has anyone ever thought of this? How many times does he open his letters with Paul, called as an apostle? Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, called not by the will of men, but by the will of who? Of God. You know, after a while, you read this and you start to think, does this guy have someone bugging him? Like, who made you an apostle? And every time he starts off his letters, he's got to start with, look, before we get into it, let me just tell you, I'm an apostle, but not because I got a certificate from, you know, XYZ denomination over here. I'm an apostle because Jesus called me to be an apostle. He's the one who sent me. His credentials weren't of man. His credentials were from above. But I have a feeling some guys must have said, who made you an apostle? You weren't there in the original 12. You know, you weren't at the supper table. How did you get to be in the group? What made you an apostle? And you know, really, to be an apostle, you had to be sent out by who? Jesus. Jesus. Now this leads into some of the technical questions, like, do we have apostles today? I always ask, is Jesus still around? Did he quit his job? Because if he quit, then we don't have any apostles. But if he didn't quit, I have a feeling he's still sending guys to serve him, to do what he calls them to do. And this, by the way, is probably one of the most near to my heart sermons to teach you that today, because this one applies to everyone. How many of you know what God has called you to do? What he called you to do. Like, not what other people say, hey, you would be good at doing this, or you should, you know, maybe you sing, oh, you should be on the worship team. And maybe, you know, some people have actually become singers on a worship team, not because they felt like God was telling them to, but someone else said, do it. You know, I'm a worship team member because my mom told me I need to be on the worship team, or my auntie told me, or, you know, and I ask them, do you feel God told you to do it? Now, can he use your auntie or your mom? Sure. They might be the very vessel that God speaks those words to you to go do your calling. But there's a difference when it's just their voice talking and when it's God talking through somebody to get you to go do something. See, I've come to learn this in a very personal way, because before I was here serving the Lord in Hawaii, I was there at Calvary Chapel Tri-City with John Higgins. And we were serving the Lord together for about 8 years and had the privilege of planting many, many different Calvary Chapels through the state of Arizona all around, and sent guys out to Bullhead City and Vegas, different. Our church was like kind of like the hub central of the region, just churches springing out from our fellowship. And it was exciting times. And we had this little short stature guy named Wally Takaki. He's about like this high. Slender little guy. Born and raised in Hilo, Hawaii. And we thought he'd talk funny, and he kicked his shoes off at the door, you know, and came into your house barefoot all the time. We thought, weirdo, because we wear our shoes in Arizona. See, we have scorpions. They can be inside or outside. We don't differentiate. Dropping your shoes at the door is not the habit there. And so we think, what's up with Wally's house? He's got like all his shoes live outside, right in a row by the door. And we weren't used to that. And here he comes up to me one day, and he walks up in the hallway of the church. And he says to me, right to my, and this is totally out of character. This guy is soft-spoken. Just picture like this little half-Japanese, he's like a kind of Japanese, all Japanese, yeah. He'd get this real soft-spoken manner, very polite. And I come from an Italian house. When we tell someone something, we're not always known for being the most polite, okay? But we get the message across, but we tell them. He comes up to me, and he, in the hall of the church, and he points at my chest. He goes like this. You need to go to the Big Island and start a fellowship. And he walked away. I was, what was that, Lord? What? And I can remember, I turned and I was walking away, scratching my head, and I remember exactly what I prayed. I was like, Lord, that guy wouldn't tell a fly to get off his hamburger at a picnic, and he's telling me I have to go to Hawaii. Can you believe that? And this little still voice, you know how God sometimes speaks to you with that little gentle inner voice? It's not no boom from heaven. I mean, this little voice goes, it wasn't him, stupid, it's me. Like, can't you figure out the messenger? That's not it's not congruent with his personality. That's not him. I made him do that. And I had known this man for years. He never talked to me like that. If I said it to him, that would be different, but he's telling me. You have to go to Hawaii. Oh, really? Hear that, God? I have to go to Hawaii. I laughed it off. Walked away, and you know, when God is trying to tell you something, when he's calling you to do something, he has this way about, like, bringing it back into your brain. Like, about the time you lay down. You lay down to go to sleep, and all of a sudden, all you can hear in your head is whatever it is that he's trying to speak to you comes back. And you can, like a fly, get out of here. Oh, where'd that come from? I don't get it. But maybe I shouldn't confess this, but you might do this a couple times, you know. And yet, does it go away? No. When he's calling you to do something, he has ways of, like, sending Wally's into your life to just go, you. And he did it. Wally, get this. I brushed it off pretty good, okay? I'm just saying. Ignore that. That was weird. And then, I don't know, a week or so goes by, and in my head, I'd been hearing it for 3 or 4 days, but I pretty much hushed it out. And then he comes up again and goes, you need to go to the Big Island. And I was like, Lord, what is his problem? And the Lord goes, what's yours? I hate this part. And so I went to men's prayer, and we had a group of men. We prayed together, Lord, on Saturday mornings and Saturday evenings there at our fellowship. And we got together, and I remember telling the men, it's about 50 guys there that day, and I said, guys, Wally says, pointed over one, Wally says, I have to go to the Big Island and start a fellowship. What do you think about that, huh? But just in case it's the Lord trying to speak through him, we should pray about it, right? And I remember going, Lord, we can't afford it. I'm the, quote, assistant pastor at the church. And the church, every time the church would grow to a certain size, and I was, by the way, because I had my degrees in business, and John Higgins always used me to be the guy that had to do all the counting, the money, the little, you know, reports and everything, people's tithe reports. He's like, look, you're OCD and really good with numbers. You do all this stuff. Okay, John. So I do all the stuff. I do it, you know. I mean, I was raised Italian. I'm the oldest. I had to learn how to do the books from when I was little to run a business. Church books are easy compared to, like, you know, for-profit business. This is, like, simple stuff, you know. Okay, a spreadsheet, you know. Early Macintosh computers were coming out. I made a program. I invented a spreadsheet program. We share with one another in the geeky computer lab. Hey, look, I made it to do this. You can put this cell here and put that there and add it and subtract it. And, you know, we get all excited, and then we share our code with the other guy. And pretty soon it became this thing, Excel, that is used today. But it was a bunch of us goofballs writing code so that we could try to make, I was trying to make, so I wouldn't have to write by hand everyone's tithe next to their name and then add the column and add the week's giving, you know, the whole thing. I'm just going to make the computer do it. So I finally get this great victory. Look, John, I got this thing to work. And he was a computer enthusiast, we'll call it. He's like the early guy who didn't know anything about it, but was like, this is cool. I just want to do it. You know, I'm just going to buy the latest one. I said, what are you going to do with it? I don't know. I don't even know what it does. Here, take it and figure it out. Then show me. He would do that to me. I was like, okay. You know, and when you're like right in college at that, when all this stuff is coming out and it's the new buzz and you've already learned Pascal and Basic and Fortran and multi-user double helix, you learn all these different programming languages and you start going, what are we going to run it on? You know, the platforms on back then, there wasn't even computers that worked real well with this stuff. And here Macintosh comes out with this motherboard we can actually add our own circuits to. We can build it bigger. And I'm so geeky. I'm in there going, yeah, let's figure this out. And then I meet this beautiful girl whose dad works at Honeywell Motorola. It's called a Honeywell Bull, I think they called it back then. And he's designing top secret hardware. He can't even tell me what he does. But I come to find out he's inventing the chips and stuff that go in the computers that we're hoping get to us so we can run our new program. And I'm all excited. This is going to be great, you know. And John, you're going to give me the computer to try to play with it? Sure. Here, I'm going to make this thing do something. Get it all done. It's a victory. You know, we got this. And then I go, John, that guy says, I got to go to Hawaii now. And he says, this is what he says to me. So is that guy telling you? Or is God telling you through that guy. And I was like, you know when someone says something what you know the answer to, but you don't really want to say that you know that they... I mean, he already knew. He's like, Is, I don't want you to go, just telling you my personal preference, but I also don't want you to not listen to the Lord. I want you to do what the Lord is telling you. So is it the Lord telling you through him, or is it me, or is it him telling you? And I'm like, it's the Lord. You know how I can tell? This is something you need to learn, though. How do you know when the Lord is telling you to do something? When he is calling you to do something. Yeah, he gives you peace inside. Even though it might not make sense on the outside. In your heart, you know. And there's like no shaking that. You can try to ignore, you can brush off, you know, you can dance around. But see, I found out with God, it's a lot better to just give in. Because if you dance around and you ignore, then you get uneasy. And then things get uncomfortable. And stuff doesn't work out. And the Lord keeps bringing you. It's kind of like this. I want you to go through this door right here. He puts a door in front of you. This is the doorway I want you to go for your life. This is the door I'm calling you to go through. And you go, I don't really want to turn the knob. He says, let's take a walk. It's like my grandfather, come on. And you walk around the block. You can do the long walk, you know, a couple miles that way, turn right, a couple miles that way, a couple miles that way, a couple miles. And now you're coming to the last turn, and guess what? You turn, and what door is there? Right where you was at before the long walk. And he goes, you want to go in? No, not really. Oh, let's go for a walk. And you go around the block again, and you know what? Where does he always bring you back? To the door he wants you to go through. And if you can receive this, and some of you know what I'm talking about because you've done this. The good Lord has tried to direct you in a path and you skirted. But it doesn't mean he's done with you. He just brings you around the horn and let's try again. And when you finally say, all right, and turn the knob, and you begin to go that way that he tells you to go, what happens to your peace then? Inside. Yeah, that peace turns to joy. The joy of obedience comes into your heart. When you start to obey the Lord, what he has called you to do, you start to see things happen that you could never explain. I mean, all of a sudden we're praying with the men. Well, he says, I have to go to Hawaii. Lord, you know, I know the books. You know the books. John knows the books. There ain't no money here. Every time the church gets big enough, he goes and splits the church. Another church, you know, launches, and half the people are gone. There goes the tithes. Then it rebuilds. And we almost get ready to where I can get paid. Yay! And then he splits it again. God, I know he says you're telling him to do this, but... And the Lord's going, it's okay. It's okay. You know why it's okay? Because you don't have to be paid here. You're going there. But Lord, how can we afford it? This is my... You know, none of you ever object when God tells you to do something, right? He tells you to do something, you're like, oh, excuse me, Lord, I can't do that. You know why? But I do, okay? I say, Lord, we're so poor, we can't afford to fly to Hawaii. It's expensive, even back then, 24 years ago. I'm like, Lord, that's a lot of bucks. Because don't worry, I got it covered. America West Airlines just opened in Tempe, Arizona at this time. And a couple of my buddies got jobs at America West. And the people who work, the new employees, this is like part of the new package to the new guys, they get two buddy passes every 6 months. And these buddy passes are for them to give to their buddies. So their buddies will try out their airline so they get more people talking about the airline and the buzz about it. And I get given 7 buddy passes in the next 2 weeks after we pray. I'm like, Lord, there's only me and Jan. You're kind of going overboard here. 7 buddy pass. I get the hint. Okay, we can go. Because, see, with the buddy pass, you had to pay like the tax or something, you know, 10% of the highest fare. It was like, I'm like, Lord, even I can afford that on the assistant pastor salary. He goes, I know. Go. Go and watch what I do. Now, I want to encourage you, when God calls you to do what he calls you, and we all have different callings. This is part of the thing I want to express to you today. It's very important to know when God is calling you, and if you can receive it, it's really important to know what was his calling for you. If you can know what he's calling you to do, Peter wrote this. When Peter's writing, he says, make your calling and your election sure. Know what it is that God has called you, elected you to do. You know, if we're electing someone to be in office, and we say, we're electing you into public office, but we're not going to tell you your title or what you're in charge of. You're just going to be a servant. What do you want me to do to serve? I mean, I served in our fellowship over there, but I kind of like the treasurer dude and the assistant pastor and the youth leader. Pretty much the youth leader is how I looked at it. Just happened to be good at numbers and computers. And you know how God uses you, whatever gifts you have? Just his style, you know? He's like, you'll make a good youth leader, and you can help out John and do that on the side. Okay, Lord, I'll do whatever you want. And I knew I was doing what I was supposed to do. Until he says, now you're moving. I'm sending you to go do something else. And I'm like, now, did God ever waste stuff that he brings you through? You think any of that 8 years with John was, like, wasted? No, that was all training. See, by the time I got here, I had my own Excel program running smooth on a new platform. I had a MacBook. Actually, we didn't call it that. I think it was called a PowerBook 100. That's how long ago this was. Some of you guys don't even know what that is. That's a black and white monitor, Apple first generation laptop. I had one of the first ones. I know, because John bought it. And then he bought the next one, the 140, I think it was, and I got the 100. I'm like, wow, I get to go. Like, I'm going on missions. I'm high tech. You guys laugh today. That thing can't do half of what your smartphone does now. But back then, that was like the most powerful processor tool in a little teeny package. I was like, I'm like high teching it, going on missions to Hawaii with buddy passes. Let's go, Jesus. See what'll happen. And on top of it, I forgot to mention, I had been praying for my father, my earthly father, Frank, that he would come to know Jesus. Because my whole life I was taught from my father how to run business, how to make money, and money was his God. And so I had to learn everything about how money works. I went on and got my master's in finance years later. And to him, that was important. But I wanted him to know Jesus, because even if you gain all, the Bible says if you gain all the riches of this world and you forfeit your soul, right? Have you really gained anything? No. And my father didn't know the Lord in a personal way, and I kept praying for him for 10 years. God, please help my dad to know you. And the Lord, in his timing and in his calling for me to come to Hawaii, in between that, my grandfather passed away, went to be with Jesus on Thanksgiving, right before it was 91. And then Christmas of 91, my brother Joseph gets killed in a head-on collision. And so my dad loses his father and his son. I'm the oldest, then my brother Joseph was the next of the boys, you know. And so he loses one son, his father, then his son. And at Christmas, he also closed the pizzeria that we had, because the owner was going to take the shopping center and facelift it and would have to be closed for about 2 years. And we knew it would crush our business, that we had spent years and years to you know, get the following we had. We had a Peter Piper pizza in Clovis, California. And it is a lot of sweat and you know, tears, so to speak, went into getting that thing to become successful. Just paid off all the ovens and all the stuff. And then got told, well, you have to close down because I want to keep up with the new shopping center across the street. And ours is old. We got to have a facelift. We're going to close everybody down. We're next to the number one grossing Kmart in the whole entire nation. And we got this product that's, you know, Peter Piper was like cheap pizza, but good. Homemade, fresh dough every day. And it was based on volume. The only way we made money was we had to sell a lot of pies. If we didn't, we went under. And now he's going to make Kmart and us close for a year and a half. If we wanted the space, we could have it still, but it was going to be not available to get in the parking lot. And would have killed our business. My dad decided, it's time to step out. So he closes. Now, he doesn't know that his son is going to die that night. He hands out the checks, severance pay to all of his workers, pays them for my dad's very generous, pays them all a couple months pay because it's Christmas time. He doesn't want them to feel like, so he gives them 2 months of salary, everybody, and says, I have to close because the shopping center is going to be closed, and I want you to be able to find some work, so this will get you covered for the next couple months. And that night, as he's getting ready to finish closing up, he gets a call and says, get to the hospital right away. Your son's been in an accident. And that night, my brother goes to be with Jesus. Now, this is my brother who told me about Jesus. Okay, so I know where he is. No problem there. But my father does not. So I get to preach first at my grandfather's funeral on Thanksgiving, then at my brother's funeral right after Christmas. And then comes New Year's, and my dad calls me and says, So what's going on? Happy New Year's. I said, Dad, I'm going to Hawaii. The Lord told me to go and start a church. And you know what my dad said? He said, I'll go with you. I'll help you. Excuse me, Dad. Maybe you didn't hear me. I'm going to start a church. Church. Say it real slow. Maybe you hear me. I'll go with you, son. I'm thinking, oh, God, I have the Antichrist for my... This is the stupidest idea ever. He has mocked my Christian faith. He has take jabs at me all the time. Wait, did you hear what I said? Dad, wait, thanks. But, I'm going to start a church. Got that church? He said, yeah, I'll help you. And this is not going to, in my understanding, this is not going to work out well. And so as we get to come here, the Lord puts us through a series of obstacles and trials and, just the things of life. And try traveling with a man who has learned how to rely on himself and his own strengths and go say, I'm going to go rely upon God and follow his lead. Do you know how this works? Like the Odd Couple, the two of you, one spiritually go God, another one like no God. And we're going to be together. And so we're on the plane, and he's going, hey, son, where are we going to stay? The flight goes straight into Honolulu, not to this island. This is where I know the Lord's telling me to go, but we're not here yet. Where are we going to go? Where are we going to stay the first day? I said, Dad, there was an auntie. We didn't call her auntie. It was a sister, one of the gals that was a volunteer receptionist at Calvary Tri-City. When she heard that I shared, hey, the Lord's calling me to Hawaii, she said, I have a friend in Hawaii. But when you say Hawaii to a mainlander, what island do they think of? Oahu, right? I said, well, we're not going to Oahu for planting the church. We're going to the Big Island. She goes, oh, she lives on the Big Island. I said, we're going to the side of the Big Island, because, they don't know geography over there. We're going to the side of the Big Island, the dry side, Kona. She said, oh, she lives in Kona. I'll call her and tell her to put you up when you get there. Now, this sister, a dear sister, she's there every week faithfully as a volunteer receptionist. But she's like, I got to go home and find her number. I'll try to get it to you. Well, she called. She couldn't get a hold of her. So when I come back, and I know I'm leaving in a couple days, have you heard? She goes, I haven't been able to get a hold of her. But don't worry, I'll get a hold of her. Okay, so it comes down to the last day before I go. I call her. I haven't yet, but I'll get a hold of her. Don't you have a conference to go to when you get there? And they were having the Calvary Chapel Pastors Conference in Honolulu. Same guys that taught over in California were going to come and teach in Hawaii just like a month later. So I had already gone to the Calvary Chapel Conference in Costa Mesa. And then to come here and hear the same guys speak, but now they're in slippers. In a Hawaiian shirt. Aloha shirt. And they're way chill, Like, I mean, Greg Laurie just can really do beach stuff really easy. And Raul Reese is a crack-up when you put him in an Aloha shirt. You know, he just chills out. He walks different. He gets up to the stage. He's all relaxed. And the word, it was the same text they were teaching. But I tell you, it was better when we came to Hawaii. The sweetness, just the sweetness came out. And that's what I got to bring my dad to hear as his first intro. But I forgot to mention, when we were flying here, he's going, where are we going to stay? And my dad, about that, I called over to Calvary Chapel, Honolulu. This guy, Bill Stonebreaker, answered, and he's been serving the Lord for a long time. He's like one of the first guys God sent out there. And I told him, you know, we were praying about going to this big island, this place, Kona, and asked him what he thought, and told him, you know, how the Lord had been letting me know I'm supposed to go. And he goes, funny you should ask. I said, I don't want to step on anyone's toes. He goes, oh, that's okay. I can't get anyone to go to Kona. And I went, now I know it's the Lord. I watched too much Star Trek. Go where no man has gone before, right? And now they don't even want to go. That's me. Send me there, right, Lord? Okay, I'll go. And I knew God was saying, see, go. And so I know you're busy. If there's anyone who could help me, I'm going to be bringing my wife and my dad, who doesn't know the Lord. And we're going to be landing there, and we're going to go to the conference with you. Is there any way that someone could have, like, a floor that we could sleep on, couch, whatever? We're not picky. And he goes, I'll see what I could do. Well, I also called him from Arizona before I left and said, Bill, is there any way you had a chance to see if there's anyone could take us in or, you know, even give us a ride to the conference? Or some, you know, I don't know my way around over there. I have been there because I competed for ASU in gymnastics, but that was, like a different, I just jumped in a van with a bunch of gymnasts and they took us everywhere. So I couldn't say I could navigate Oahu. So I said, just truthfully, I don't know my way around. He goes, don't worry. I'll see what I can figure out. Well, we're leaving. This is the before cell phones, guys. So when you get there, you got to use the thing on the wall called a payphone, put money in, dial. The kids don't know about these. And you call up, and so I leave Arizona, and I got my dad now with me. And he says, where are we going to stay when we get there? All I know is Bill Stonebreaker said he'll try to work out something. And the auntie in Arizona said she'll try to get a hold of her friend. So, but I know one thing. Who told me to go? God. This is a very important part of the calling thing. When it comes to knowing that you are called to do something, you need to make sure you know who it is that called you. Because if God's calling you to do it, see, I was modeled this truth that Chuck Smith taught us, where God guides, God what? Provides. So you just got to walk where he tells you, and he'll take care of what you need. And so try to tell a man who's relied on himself and his own strengths his entire life, self-made man, your father, that you're going to rely on your heavenly father, not on your earthly father. This, like, goes over like a lead balloon, you know? And I'm a young whippersnapper in his eyes. I'm 28 years old, and I'm going to do what God says. And, you know, a 28-year-old doesn't hold a lot of weight to the... It was 59 at the time. And he's looking at me like... I said, don't worry, Dad, God's going to take care of it. And then I'm like this in my seat. Oh, God, you got to take care of it, please. And I land in Honolulu. We get our bag. We go to the out to the curb. And I haven't even seen a payphone yet. And I'm not sure what to do. And I'm like, Lord, you know, if Bill could get someone, you know what to do. And the Lord goes, I got you covered. And I walk out. And you know how busy Honolulu Airport is? You know, I mean, there's like gazillions of people zooming in and out and going like, I mean, they're kind of maniacs over there. Like, even 24 years ago, it was a little bit like a zoo. They come whipping and I look over, there's this little white, like, Nissan Sentra car, little four-door compact thing sitting there, and there's this black girl. A black girl with the most prettiest white teeth. You know how sometimes black girls, their teeth... like super white. I mean, this girl like had the most brightest smile you have ever seen. But it wasn't just her smile. She's smiling and she's standing there, leaning against her car, and she's got like this glow. Like the light of the Lord is just shining out of her. And I look at her and the Lord goes, "That's your ride." Just a word of it's called a word of knowledge. It's a gift from God's Spirit. I was really happy to have this word of knowledge that day. I was like, he goes, "That's your ride." And I look at her and I don't even know her. I mean, I'm stepping out of an airport. I got my dad going, "Where are we going to stay? Where are we going to stay?" You know, on the plane, I finally got so annoyed. I reached in my wallet and I pulled out a credit card. I said, "Dad, do you have one of these pieces of plastic?" You know, I waved it at him and he's like looking at it. "Yeah, I got one of those." I said, "Well, I got one too." So quit bugging me about where we're going to stay. If worst comes to worst, push comes to shove, we both got a piece of plastic, and we can go to some hotel, and this is Oahu, man. This is like, you know, tourista capital of the whole Hawaiian island. We can get a place to stay. But I don't think God needs this to take care of us. And I put it back in my wallet, and I said, "Let's see what he'll do." And now I'm on the line. Oh, Lord, I just said that. I can't believe. Oh, now you... You know, and when I come out the doors there, and everyone's pulling up, going away, and I look, and there's this girl just smiling. And she looks at me, and I look at her, and the Lord goes, "That's your ride." And I look right at her, and we lock eyes. And she, it's like the same as the Lord told me she's my ride. She looked at me, and the Lord must have told her, "I'm the guy you're there to pick up." And she looks at me, "You're the pastor." But not like a question. Like, "You're the pastor. I know. Just, how do you know? God just told me." She goes, "I'm Bernice. I'm your ride." It's like, "See, Dad?" And thank you, Jesus. And she just come this way. And she's just got this gift of hospitality. Opens the truck, get your stuff in. Everybody loads in, jumps in. "Come on, guys." And she drives us down to downtown Honolulu and gets there, I think King Street, one of these main streets, you know, and goes to this private gated high rise. And she swings in and pushes the code and gets in, and she goes right to the penthouse parking stall, right by the elevator. And I think, she's just, you know, probably not supposed to park here, and gonna say, "Hurry, jump, get your stuff out, and then I'll go park," or something. And she just jumps out, grabs her stuff, puts the stuff out, puts it by the elevator, puts her key in, gets in the elevator with us, and she has to put her key in the elevator to push P. And she pushes it for the penthouse, the top. And she pushes P, and she takes us up, and she comes and she opens up the door, and she takes us in, and she says, "This is my place, and you guys are going to stay here while you're here for the conference, and I'm going to go stay with friends, and here's the numbers, and there's food in the fridge, and the bed's over there, and this is here, you know, here's the keys to my car. My friend's going to come pick me up. You just use the car. You saw where it was right outside the elevator there. You use it all you want. And here's the directions to straight down this road right over there. That's where Calvary Honolulu is." And she, like, had acquainted us on the way, but then she'd give us a little map and make sure we could get to the conference. "And have a blessed day, and I'll see you at the conference. Bye." And closes the door and leaves. And my dad... He's like, he looks out over the thing, and it's like the view to kill. I mean, it's, you know, the whole, like, one side you see the whole ocean, the Waikiki, and then you go to the other side, and you look, there's this beautiful park, and there's this, like, you know, mountain scene, and clouds, and, like, rainbows there, and I'm like, "What do you think, Dad?" Mr., you know, always impressed with real estate things, he's like just bugged out. He's like, "Wow, when you travel with God, you travel in style, you know?" And I'm thinking inside, this never happens. God's just showing off for him. I mean, seriously, we would have slept on a couch, the floor. We didn't care. But God was trying to show himself to who? To my dad. And then, after the week of the conference, we wind up, we're going to come here. And guess what conversation comes up on the plane? "Where are we going to stay?" I still haven't heard from the receptionist at Calvary Tri-City. So I pull out the plastic, Dad, do you have one of these? Only this time I got a little more. You know, we've had a week in a penthouse, okay? So, like, but you know, I would rather see what God will do. And they put the plastic back, and it's a short flight, 38 minutes, and we're here. And we land, and Jan looks out the window and goes, great, God's called us to the moon. So we're coming in over the lava. And all I could hear in my mind was, listen to this. She said it. God's what? Called us. Not maybe God has called us here, or great, we got to go check it out and see if he's called. She went, God's called us to the moon. And I went, and it was so weird because we're landing. I'd never been here. And the Lord goes, you're home. You're where I want you to be. You know, home is where he tells you to be. If you obey, that will be the home for you. You know, I'm from Arizona. I'm home here now because this is where he told me to go. And I listened to his calling. Now, when I land, I don't know where we're going to stay. And, okay, coming from a big city and a big airport where you got to get to the baggage claim, then you got to go outside the baggage claim before you can even see a person from the outside because they're not even allowed in. All of a sudden, the plane lands on the tarmac and they wheel up some stairs and you come down these little rickety stairs. And they were pretty junk back then. They've improved them. And we get down to the bottom and we're standing on tarmac. And there's a little rock wall like that one over there. A little building. Where's your airport? That's it. Wow. We weren't international yet. It's just, you know, small kind. And we get there, and I look, and I'm like, Lord, I don't know if the auntie got a hold of the people. And Lord goes, I got you covered. And my dad's like, where are we going to stay? And I look, and by the rock wall, there's this old couple. And they're standing there, just smiling. And they got that glow, that same glow. And there goes, that's who you're staying with. Second word of knowledge in one trip, man. I'm like going, okay. The first one worked out real good. I sure hope you're right, Lord. You know, to walk up to a total stranger and go, are you where I'm staying tonight? If you don't think that this is a test of your faith, let me tell you. Especially when you're got a guy in tow who doesn't, you know, really believe in God. This is like extra hard. And I walk up to them. And Lord goes, that's it. That's your ride. That's where you're staying. And I'm like, hi, I'm Izzy from Arizona. Are you who I'm staying with? And they said, yeah, we're Brian and Joan Stebbins. And we, our friend got a call from her friend on the mainland. And she was going to have you stay with them, but her daughter just got back, and so she has the room full, so she can't take you. So she called us and asked if we would take you. Okay. Works for me. We get out of the airport, we turn, then we get to the first light, not even a light back then, it was just a stop sign. Palani Road. No, not Palani. Palisades Road. We like just left the airport, turned, we went up and stopped at their house. We get to the house, it's got a balcony, looks right down over the whole coast. Now my dad, Mr. Real Estate, location, location, location. You know, like the view was to die for. They had an empty lot in front of them, no one blocking it. Full out, their lanai was just like, my dad was in heaven on earth, you know. He's like, this is paradise. So you eat your papaya and look at that. And Joan does not believe in serving food like on paper plates. We had silverware china with silver rimmed plate in the morning. We had gold rimmed plate in the evening. We had like platinum or some other, you know, she got like different dishes for each, and she sets this major spread, and she fed me quiche with lots of butter. She's fattened me up. I was skinny. Like, you need to wait, you know. 1 week with her, I think I gained like 10 pounds. I mean, that woman could gift a hospitality. She went to be with the Lord. But here's the kicker. We walk in the door. I don't know these people, right? I'm telling my dad, let's just trust God. God's got, we'll see what God will do. and to bring us into their house. And I look on the refrigerator, and there's a picture of Dick Scott, the pastor of Calvary Chapel, Monterey, the one I had just been speaking with at my brother's funeral. There's his picture on their refrigerator with his little Christmas, you know, newsletter thing. I'm like, you know him? I said, oh, yeah, we let a Calvary Chapel start in our house in you know, around Clovis area in California, Monterey. And so you know Joe Manzo? I said, oh, yeah, we know Joe and Joni. They were wonderful. They were one of our first couples. We had them since we started in the garage. And they start talking about Joe and Joni like, you know, we just talked to them just like right before Christmas. They don't know that Joe has gone to be with Jesus yet. They don't know that I'm his brother and that the guy we have with us is a dad who's watching the whole thing and can't comprehend how we could be in Hawaii received by these two people that act like angels and take us to their house. And the very first thing we do is when we meet them is, you know, oh, that, you know, Dick's, yeah. Well, I'm his brother. I'm Joseph's older brother. He's the one who told me about Jesus. Oh, yeah, that sounds just like Joe. And la, 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 you know. And she starts talking about Joe, and my dad is can't even contain it. I mean, you know, he's like trying to hold it together. And he starts talking to this couple, and come to find out, they had their very business in Arizona, where I was born and raised, like 3-4 blocks from my father's business. At the same years, then when my father moved to California and did the pizza business, Brian moved over to do some bookkeeping for some guy over there in the garlic capital of the world and doing all this work for him and bookkeeping. And so they wound up pulling over there, and they went to our restaurant. They went to the Kmart next door. We were like living side by side in the same seasons of life, in the same cities, at the same time frame, and never met them. Not that we cognitively, you know, recall. We have to go all the way to Hawaii and land on some moon to be greeted by two older angels to find out that they were the ones that let the Calvary Chapel start in their house with my brother and my sister-in-law. And my dad cannot believe it. And him, Joan, she's a night owl. She stayed up with my dad talking about all the things God did, just giving glory to the Lord. And she was such a witness to him. His mind was blown. And then she fed us like kings. And after a week with her, he's like going, your God's really real, isn't he? Like, he really does take care of you. I'm like, yeah, not always this good, but, you know, I mean, I didn't want to tell him that, you know, like, I mean, it's sometimes it's bologna sandwiches, but we, you know, whatever it is, we, you know, like, because he's thinking, man, you go what God is like, this is like first class. I mean, and I'm thinking, no, it's like, I think God's just showing off for you. And I had to start teaching the book of Romans. And that was a whole nother series of miracles, how the Lord worked. When I went to the conference in California, I met some kid. He heard that we were praying about going to Hawaii. Oh, my mom lives in Hawaii. Well, we're going to this thing, the Big Island. Oh, she lives on the Big Island. We're going to Kona side of the Big Island. Oh, she lives in Kona. I'll call her. So that when we land, after she finds out we're coming, we get a knot. We find a place to stay in. And to make the story short, she comes to the door and knocks and, excuse me, and my dad answers. Are you the pastor come to start in the cabin? Oh, no, that's my son, he says. Well, I'm Claretto, and she lived two streets away at this ginormous house in Sunset. Where are you going to meet? We don't know. Talk to my son. Hey, Claretto, I get to meet her. Where are you going to meet? Come over for dinner. Okay, we come for dinner. We're sitting there having this beautiful dinner in a gorgeous house overlooking my dad, Mr. Real Estate again. Look at the view. And, yeah, boy, as you travel and stuff. And she's like, where are you going to have the church? I said, oh, we don't know. We're seeking the Lord. And we're just, I've only been here like 2 days on the island. And she's like, how about here? sure. And she had said, do you play music? And could you bring your guitar? You know, I said, yeah, I play guitar. I've been leading worship for years for the kids. Would you bring your guitar? So I brought my guitar. We had this beautiful meal. We get all done sharing all the testimonies, how the Lord brought us there with them. And they're all excited. Man, you know, he's called you and you listened. That was a big deal to them. He called you and you listened. Not listen like heard it, but listened and did it. That's great. Could you sing a song? So I sing a song. That's even better. He can sing too. So could you do me a favor? I said, what's that? I got 8 people waiting in the next room. They've been waiting for you to get here. We've been praying for someone to come and pastor a church here. And could you tell them all the stuff what you just told me? How long have they been there? Oh, the whole time we've been eating. My dad's just going, whoa. And we have our first midweek service right then. To like teach us, you know, share that testimony, teach us something. So when are we going to start? I said, well, as soon as we find a place. They say, how about here? How about next week? It was like a Wednesday. How about next Wednesday? All right. What book do you want to start in? John? You know, yeah, okay. Guys, read ahead. I'm thinking, man, I didn't even get a weekend. You know, I mean, then we have our first Wednesday study. And guess what they do to me? When are we going to start Sundays? Well, as soon as we find a place, how about here? And I couldn't argue. Her living room was bigger than from where Alfred is all the way over to where our brother's sitting on the bike. I mean, that's like about that big. And I'm just like, it's big enough. I mean, it's like bigger than most church sanctuaries. They're just there. I'm like, yeah, it'll work. They're like, will this work? Sure. And we can put Sunday school downstairs. And hey, this double-decker house is huge. I'm like, okay, works for me. This Sunday? Okay. I thought planting a church was going to take a while, you know? It's like the Lord's like, you don't get a Sunday off, man. You're going to work. Let's go. What do we study? How about the book of Romans? Let me tell you about God calling this man named Paul, who he says set him apart for the gospel. He was called by God. Who called you to do what you're doing? If it's God calling you to do something, let me tell you, there's some sweetness to obeying his call. Now, some men might question who called you. How come you get to do it? Who made you that in that position? You know, and when the answer is, the only answer you have is God, some people are going to love that answer. Some people are going to hate it, though. They're going to fight you on it. They're going to cause trouble for you. They don't believe God calls. But I'm here to tell you, God does call us all. And it's good to know, like Peter said, what your calling is. Whatever your calling is, when Peter says, make your calling, your election sure, you got to know what it is you're called to do. If you're called to be the treasurer, don't try to be the president. You know, if you're called to serve in one capacity in the gospel, make sure you do what God called you to do. I have seen so many miserable Christians throughout my years of Christian experience that the reason they're miserable isn't because they're not called to be a Christian. It's because they haven't found out what their calling is from God. Oh, they found out callings that men want them to do. You know, they got involved with different groups and someone said, hey, you should do this or that. And they kind of got roped into it, so to speak. You know, some of the most, and by the way, there are miserable Christians out there. They're busy doing, you know, like when I took over with John Higgins, I came into a church that was already going. And I was an on-fire youth leader. And they put me in the room with a bunch of kids. And I noticed that some of the adults in the room had real sour faces. And they didn't want to be there. And John said, we got to, now this is how John Higgins handled it, by the way. I just want to go on record so he can hear this someday when he, you know, get a chuckle. Here's his management style. He says, Is, there's a problem in Sunday school. Go fix it. What's the problem, John? You'll see. What? I go in, there's like people doing stuff. Everybody's hip-hopping. I mean, the church is exploding. And I didn't see it right away. You know, I'm like, okay, you know. I mean, they need more room. That's obvious. I mean, there's like so many kids, too many kids for the space, but, you know, we'll blow out this wall. There's old Peter Piper pizza. It was a Chuck E. Cheese. It was a Chuck E. Cheese pizza building we were using. We'll just blow out that wall, and we'll take that old mop closet, and we'll shove that out and re-carpet, and we'll expand that next to the other room, and then that'll be, you know, expand the nursery space, and we can make it work. And the Lord goes, that's not the problem. Look, not with these, but look with the spiritual eyes at what's going on. And I looked, and there was a bunch of these sour faces. These adults back there serving with the kids. And you could tell they didn't want to be there. And by the way, can kids tell if the people that are working with them are not kid people? It's like a dog can tell who's not a dog person. I mean, they know. And it brings out, sometimes out of a dog, it brings out the worst thing. You know, I mean, they think you don't, you know, jive with them. They get angsty or weird or aggressive or, you know. Kids do the same thing. They'll act out. They'll give you problems. And I said, can we have a meeting? And there was a bunch of people that came to that meeting. They had a schedule developed. The ladies had figured out a rotation where everyone had to be part of the group, and they were rotating in all the parents to involve them. And I said, that sounds really good, except what if the people that are coming rotating in aren't really good with kids? I had found the problem. You guys are going to hate my solution. This was my solution. Everybody that's here, who's here because you love kids, you want to just see God work in their lives, you want to help them grow in the love of the Lord, raise your hand. You know, I was young. Okay, raise your hand. Who likes to work with kids? I see who here. I see, we got people who love kids here. Okay, I noticed not all your hands went up, though, because some of you ain't good with kids. Or how many of you love babies? Like, I mean, little ones. Little, they can't talk. You just got rock them, and there we go. See, there's these ones. Those are the ones, the baby ones, I call them the baby holders. They are the ones you want doing the job, because babies can tell right away. Oh, man, are they perceptive. You hand a baby to someone who's not good with babies, and they stiffen up, right? And the baby just goes, ah! They're like, out of here, you know? And so I go, okay. Listen, if you were under, the Bible says God loves a cheerful what? Giver. This even means giving of your time and your abilities and your giftings. And, you know, if you can't cheerfully work with the kids, I want you to do me a favor. I'm going to excuse you today, and you don't have to do Sunday school service anymore. Just go in and enjoy the service, listen to John Higgins, get fed the word, and just grow in the Lord. I only want the people who really love kids to stay. Well, all of a sudden, that was like I pushed the hot button. I mean, these ladies have been working really hard to get the list and get everyone in there. And I just excused like almost 2/3 of the people. They left. They didn't come back. But do you know what happened in Sunday school? All of a sudden, there was a sweetness to the Sunday school that, I mean, we had more kids per leader. But you know what? It didn't matter. Because the kids knew the guys that were there wanted to be there. And all of a sudden, Sunday school exploded. I mean, we had so much stuff happen, and the Lord brought more people that had hearts to work with kids, and the thing just grew. And I realized how important is this truth that we learn to walk where we're called to walk. You know, if you're called to work with kids, that's where you're going to flourish. If you're not, you need to know what is your calling. Are you called to work with the elderly? Maybe you're supposed to go to the old folks' home. Or maybe you get great joy from going and visiting people. Our brother Herb goes, our chaplain, to the hospital, goes up there and prays for the sick. That's a calling, by the way. Herb, did I call you to do that? Who called you to? See him back there? The guy with the cane who's gone through so much pain? Mr. Compassionate right there when it comes to praying for people that are hurting. But you know who called him? The Lord. And it's so sweet when men and women learn what God called them to do. And all I have to do is encourage them, hey, what's the Lord call you to do? Go do it. Even John Higgins, when I told him, I know the Lord's telling me to go, he's like, I don't want you to go, but I want you to do, not what I want, he said, but what the Lord is telling you to do. Listen to his calling. And that's probably one of the hardest things to do. That's true spiritual maturity, by the way. When you find someone that you work really well with and you know God's calling them on to go do something else, it's hard to let them go, isn't it? Yet, Paul, when he writes to Timothy, he'll say to Timothy, Timothy, you need to fulfill your calling, your gifting. You're called as an evangelist. He said, do the work of an evangelist. He's telling him to fulfill. He says, fulfill your ministry. So many times, I think in Western Christianity, the focus is on fulfilling whatever the pastor's passion is, whatever his love is, you know, let's fulfill that. But it shouldn't be. It should be each of us individually doing what God has called each of us to do. Whatever he called you to do, I want to encourage you, do what he told you to do. Because the body of Christ gets built up the most when each of us do that thing what we were called to by the Lord. And Paul, if you don't get this, who called him to this? Who set him apart for the gospel? Jesus. This is his credentials. Jesus called me. We went over his conversion last week, how he got smitten by the Lord there with that bright light, brighter than the sun at high noon, and put scales over his eye, blinded him for 3 days. And the Lord said, I got to talk to you. You were persecuting me, now I'm going to use you. Here's what you're going to suffer. And he went on. Now, I had a man tell me, Pastor Mick Meyer was his name. He's with the Lord too now. But he had spent time planting a church in Maui, a Calvary, many years ago. And he said, don't go. When he heard I was praying about coming here, don't go. It's a really hard spiritual place. Everyone thinks it's paradise, but spiritually it's a battleground. He said, it's chewed up and spit out so many guys. And he was one of the fellows. He said, don't do it. And this is what it come down to this. When one guy is telling you not to do it, and who was telling me to do it? The Lord. Who are you going to listen to? Hopefully. To Jesus. Listen, this is the hardest thing to tell you, but it's worth teaching you. I can say it by example. I don't ever try to preach what I don't live. But today is 24 years. 24 years ago, sitting here preaching this very book. I got much farther in one day by then. But I didn't have the depth of understanding of how important it was to do what he called me to do. Because following his calling led to seeing, you know, CSN radio stations get put throughout the islands, the Effect Radio, 9 years of fighting with the FCC to get Christian radio through the islands. The food basket that we have today that was from a thing called Love Inc. that we started, a food pantry, became the Love Inc., then the food pantry, then the food basket today it's called, the white food basket. You guys heard of that. That's what we use for getting a lot of our stuff. All of that, and this whole area has changed from our church being here. 15 years out on this beach, and I think, I never thought we would ever do just... I was used to a thermostat on the wall. You know, you want to change the temperature, you turn a little dial. God goes, that's too easy. You're relying on, not on me, on you're relying on man's ingenuity. I'll be in charge of your AC. Every week, I'm like, God, you got to control the thermostat. It's getting a little warm, Lord. Could you turn the breeze up? Do you know how faithful God is when you talk to him about even little stuff? Like right now, anyone give the amen a little more AC? You feel the breeze? Did it just come up?
Yep.
See, for those people in the audience, the breeze just picked up right when it just... God is a God who hears our prayers. It's good to know that we can call on him. And he has a calling for you. Just listen to it. He'll lead you in it. We'll go over more of the stuff of the callings and the gifting. Well, the giftings is what comes next. Okay, callings and giftings are they're two separate things, but they're complements to one another. They go hand in hand, but they are different. And so the kids ask, what's the difference? Next week I'll go into that. You want to know more about the gifts that God has for us? Stick around. Next week we'll go further in Romans to see how Paul is going to explain some of the details of the gifts. Not in depth, just the big sense. Anyone want a gift from the Lord? You're going to love next week. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this time. I thank you for your faithfulness, Lord, that you're a God that has kept my wife and I here safe all these years, Lord. And oh yeah, Lord, I forgot that one really great praise. You let my dad come to know you. After 9 months of preaching the gospel in front of him, he gave his life to you, Lord. And for that, that's my biggest praise report. Of all of these labors, Lord, my dad is in heaven with you right now. And so for that, Lord, I say, tell him hi for me. Tell him glad that he was with me to start this church. And I'm really grateful, Lord, for these 24 years. I give you praise. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. This is my new Father's Day jug. My kids said my jug wasn't big enough. This one actually holds almost twice what my old one held. I guess they want me to have bigger guns. This is my curls, so. So we have that. Why don't you stand?
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.